Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Beyond the Fray, Bigfoot, by Shannon LeGro and G. Michael Hopf. Narrated by Tanya Eby and Alex Knox. Introduction. I often get asked why I became so interested in the subject of Sasquatch. I really can't answer that question simply, as I can't trace it back to an exact time and place, but it's fair to say my fascination goes well beyond just that topic alone. I have what can only be described as a hunger to explore and uncover all the unknown, those not readily explained things that cohabitate with us, and for some, manifest before their eyes. This hunger for knowledge has taken me far and wide, from searching for Sasquatch across many states while filming the documentary On the Trail of Bigfoot, to investigating the notoriously haunted Fox Hollow Farm in Indiana, and conducting research on Mothman in none other than Point Pleasant, West Virginia. I've chalked up many miles, have found some evidence, but uncovering definitive proof has eluded me. Yet I'll never tire or give up. As of the publication of this book, I've been hosting and producing the popular podcast Into the Fray since September of 2015. My show has two purposes. The first is to showcase experts and renowned researchers covering all topics in the paranormal and cryptid community. The second purpose, and one that I believe in my heart is the most important, is to provide a safe harbor for the many who have had encounters with such things as demons, Sasquatch, dogmen, shadow people, UFOs, you name it. On my show, they can open up and share their personal stories without judgment or fear of repercussion. For far too long, they have felt marginalized, outcast, ridiculed, and some harassed, simply because they have come up against something they can't explain. After mentioning all of this, I still haven't answered why I do what I do. Why have I dedicated my life to pursue these answers? Why do I tirelessly explore, knowing that I may never find the truth? To answer these questions, I'll need to take you back to when I was 12 and to the beautiful mountain setting surrounding Cedar Mountain in Duck Creek Village, Utah. My father had a cabin in Duck Creek Village, a tiny hamlet nestled near Bryan Head Ski Resort and 5 hours from our house in Las Vegas. If you're familiar with Duck Creek today, you'll know how quaint it is. Back then, it was simply one very small general store, a bait shop, 6 little rental cabins, and a hotel that always seemed to be under construction. During this time in my life, we spent a considerable amount of time in Duck Creek. Our days would be filled with hiking, fishing, target practice with pellet guns, and one of my favorite pastimes as a kid, riding my four-wheeler. On most days, we could be found traversing the trails and dirt roads on our four-wheelers up until way past sundown. Just up from Duck Creek was a steep graded dirt road that led to the privately owned cabins that sparsely dotted the landscape. The dirt roads crisscrossed the entire area, and with hardly any vehicle traffic to be concerned about, you could pretty much ride unencumbered. The particular day in question was bright and sunny. Not a cloud dotted the intensely blue sky, and the moderate temperature required only a light jacket. We would frequently ride without our helmets on. Not the brightest thing to do, but it was often the case. This day was no different. It was mid-morning, and my brother and stepbrother were riding in front of me a little ways, not because I couldn't keep up. Nope, it was because I hated getting dust in my eyes. To say we were going fast would be a lie. We were hauling ass. With the throttles of our machines opened up, we sped down a long and straight road we knew very well. This was living, and I loved it. I caught a glimpse of something to my right. I glanced over and saw something running parallel to me about 30 feet in the forest. I kept looking, and to my shock, saw 4 human-shaped black silhouetted figures. The sun was casting through the trees, yet its rays didn't affect these figures, as if the light couldn't or didn't reflect or wasn't able to shine on them. It's hard to explain, but these 6-foot-tall figures are the only objects I've ever seen devoid of light. It was as if they were animated cutouts from the blackest cloth you could ever imagine. What was even more startling and frightful was these things kept pace with me. Their arms and legs moved with ease as they traversed through the forest without disturbing even a leaf or branch. Fear rose in me as I wondered if they'd look my way. Would they be faceless voids, similar to their bodies, or would I see a monstrous expression? I didn't want to know, and thankfully I didn't have to, as they kept their gaze ahead. I watched them for what I estimated to be a count of 5, but I'll say now it seemed like an eternity. I set my gaze back on the road in front of me to check my path of travel, then looked back, thinking they'd be there, but they were gone. As I sit and type this, being the investigator I am now, I wish I could say I slowed down, stopped, or went back, but I didn't. I pushed my machine as fast as it would go until I caught up with my brothers. When I reached them, I wasn't hysterical but was visibly upset. They knew something was wrong when I said I wanted to go back to the cabin. As kids, the cabin was a place to sleep, nothing more, as our lives were outdoors. My brief encounter not only affected my time there, as I didn't ride again for almost a week, terrified of what I would see with a simple glance into the woods, it altered my life. Those 5 seconds changed my entire view of the world. I shared with my father what I had seen. He told me it was probably just military men conducting training exercises. Unless these men were outfitted with some sort of amazing technology for Superman-like running speed and a black-as-night starter kit, those were not men, military or otherwise. Those 5 seconds have been the only unexplained thing I've ever seen with my own eyes, and it is the reason I do this work. As scared as I was, it created this insane drive and questions. So many questions. What were they? Why were they there? Why did I see them when I did? It's too late for me to turn back. I'm in the hunt not just to find the answers to those questions, but all things unexplained. This takes me to this book. Some say the recent search for Sasquatch or Bigfoot officially began on September 21, 1958, when journalist Andrew Genzoli of the Humboldt Times featured a letter from a reader about loggers in Northern California. The reader stated that loggers had discovered mysterious, large footprints. Genzoli thought the letter fun, so he played along by stating in his column, which ran alongside the letter, "Maybe we have a relative of the abominable snowman of the Himalayas." What Genzoli didn't know, and to his surprise, was the letter would ignite an interest and fascination in readers. The response was so good that he and fellow Humboldt Times journalist Betty Allen published follow-up articles about the footprints. In one of those follow-up articles, they reported the name loggers had given the so-called creature whose tracks were becoming popular. That name was Bigfoot. While America became transfixed on Bigfoot in 1958, history shows us that talk of a creature or wild man living in the wilds of North America wasn't new. Native Americans, as well as early American settlers, long detailed stories and tales of hairy, giant, upright, human-slash-ape-like beings living in the woods. In fact, many cultures around the world have such folklore. For as many cultures have their stories, they also have their own unique names for the creature, with one becoming renowned. And that name is Sasquatch. The name Sasquatch is taken from the Stahelis people of Chehalis, a First Nation people whose territories are in British Columbia, Canada. Some in the modern age have described Sasquatch as a gentle creature, while others describe him as fierce and something to be feared. During my time conducting research and hosting my show, I have listened to many share their accounts. Some of these, while startling, provide evidence that Sasquatch can simply be curious and doesn't harm people, while others detail violent and threatening altercations. It is these particular stories I've compiled into this book for you to enjoy and use as a cautionary tale for when you journey into the woods. I want to thank you for being here. You're about to take an intense trip, one filled with terrifying personal eyewitness encounters with the elusive Bigfoot, so buckle up. And finally, to my loyal podcast listeners and fans, for years I've taken you into the fray. Together, we've explored the unknown, the mysterious, the strange, and the bizarre. You have been my companions as we seek to find answers. Yet, if we never do, the journey itself has been the price of admission and well worth it. Now come with me as we again depart, but this time go beyond the fray. Chapter 1. Like many people who have had experiences with Sasquatch, David has been afraid to ever disclose, much less ever mention to family or friends, the terrifying encounter he had with the elusive creature, for fear of being mocked or ridiculed. David's encounter can only be described as terrifying. And as you hear his own words, you'll see this to be true. I'll finish with this. He had always wanted an encounter with Sasquatch and was willing to do anything to have it. But as you'll see, we should sometimes be careful what we ask for, because we just might get it.
Boundaries crossed. As a kid, I was always more interested in things like UFOs, ghosts, Bigfoot, things like that. Probably one of the biggest mistakes my mom ever made was giving me a copy of The Amityville Horror at a very young age, probably too young to have been appropriate reading. But regardless, that started my interest in all things paranormal. I remember watching a show when I was a little kid. I forget the exact name of it, but it was the first time I saw the Patterson-Gimlin film. As my young eyes watched the Sasquatch walk along the creek bed, I became hooked. From that point on, I studied whatever I could find, watched everything I could get my hands on, which was limited for a kid in the 1970s because the only resources were libraries and such. My passion for Bigfoot did have its limits, though, and eventually died out as I went into my teen years. In high school, I replaced the paranormal with music and whatever else was hip for the average teenager. However, as I entered my 20s, the interest in the mysterious and unknown rekindled in me. It was like an old friend whom you only see every now and then, but when you speak, you pick up right where you left off, no matter how long it's been. I have to admit that what helped usher back my keen awareness and curiosity was a coincidence, a chance meeting, a crossing of paths, to be more exact, with a gentleman who was pretty well known in the Bigfoot research community. He and I hit it off almost immediately, almost like we'd known each other our whole lives. While we had become friends, he also took on the role of a teacher or mentor of sorts. He taught me all he knew concerning Sasquatch, never leaving a detail out. We spent many hours in the woods, covering all that I needed to know about how to study and compile research. One thing that he told me, and I had no reason to believe otherwise, was that the creature was nothing more than a gentle giant, that it didn't mean us any harm. I'd read of a few encounters that had been described as violent, but I was led to believe that this was extremely rare. Sasquatch was merely a gentle, kind, and curious creature, a sweet denizen of the forest. I was told that as long as I was respectful, no harm would ever come to me. Well, I've since changed that opinion, and will detail the events that led up to my fateful day. It was 2001, and on an excursion into the woods, my mentor and I were out to research an area that was known by some to have a significant amount of activity. As we hiked back to one of the spots, we stopped to take a break. I pulled out a map. I always took topo maps with me. You can never be too careful when you're out in the wilderness. Seeing the map in my hands, he took it from me and, using a marker, circled an area that was only a couple of hundred yards off a particular trail that had been marked earlier. He gave me a serious look and said, "Don't ever go here." Not having seen him often with such a serious look, I replied, "All right, I won't." My curiosity was heightened, so I asked, "Why is that?" "Well," he replied, with a pause to gather his thoughts, "I believe this is where they live." I knew what that meant. The other areas were parts they roamed, hunted, etc. The circled area was their home, a place they could feel safe. I was still curious, so I asked him, "What makes you believe that?" "I have had a few encounters there, and they've all been with younger ones or juveniles." "All right, I will never go there," I said, although the desire to go was burning in me. Plus, I'm not a fan of being told I can't do something. He shot me a hard look, knowing I was a rebel at heart. "Okay, I'll never go there," I relented, as I picked up on his body language. However, deep down, I knew I was coming back and that I'd have to do it alone. Upon returning home, I planned my trip back. Since I only lived 6 hours away, that made it easy, too. I told my wife I was going on a business trip, which wasn't a stretch, as I often did for my work. The morning came for my lone trek to the forbidden area. I remember the day like no other, In fact, I often can't get it out of my thoughts. It was fall, but the cool chill of autumn hadn't taken hold yet. My need to go outweighed my normal precautions for hiking and exploring the wilderness. I literally broke every rule as far as safety goes, with the biggest one being that I told no one where I was going. And I mean that. Not a soul knew. I arrived, parked my car, and set out on what I estimated would be a 45-minute to an hour hike to get to the area where I wasn't supposed to go. My plan for the day was to just go there and poke around a little, see what I could see. Essentially, what I'm saying is I didn't even prepare for the hike and went without many items I normally take. I think I had a bottle of water, a couple of things to eat, light snacks, but nothing major. I arrived into the area, found a place to sit with a vantage point, and decided to just see what would happen. I recalled that I didn't see any signs, the things we usually look for while doing research. As time ticked away with nothing happening, I thought to myself, well, I'll hang out for a little while longer. I can't recall how much time went by, but enough without anything happening to get bored. I thought about leaving, but I couldn't because I had devoted my time to this, and because of the idea that if I stayed, I would finally get what I so wanted, and that was to see or experience Sasquatch firsthand. As it was fall, evening began to approach early. It was then that I decided to stay the night. I knew it would be scary, but I figured it was too late to walk out, so I settled in for the long night. My plan was to get up at the crack of dawn, hike back, and be home before anyone really missed me. I sat back and got as comfortable as I could. The weight of fatigue soon overwhelmed me, and before I knew it, I was asleep. Sounds of movement jogged me from my slumber. I lay there listening and straining to see. It wasn't pitch black, but dark to the point where you almost can't see your hand in front of your face. Again, I heard something moving. It sounded large, very large. Aside from the sounds of movement, the woods were eerily quiet. My body tensed as the movement grew closer and closer. Then, out of nowhere, what I can only describe as hellish screams came from the darkness. These were screams I'd never heard before, and they shook me to the core. The comparisons to a woman being killed are accurate to a point. What I wasn't prepared for was the sheer volume and forcefulness. More screams came. These were from a different part of the woods, then another. It seemed as if they were now coming from every direction except from behind me, and the only reason I could figure was because I had positioned myself against a steep hill and faced out. I had a flashlight, and as much as I wanted to turn it on, I didn't for a couple of reasons. First, I didn't want to see what was making this noise, and second, I didn't want whatever was making this noise to see me, even though I assumed they already had. My instinct was to get up and make a run for it. This was coupled by my thoughts screaming at me to do the very same thing. Using every ounce of courage I could muster, I got to my feet. My body was trembling uncontrollably, my breathing had increased, and my heart was pounding in my chest heavily. Still, the screams kept coming with ever-increasing intensity. I took two steps to my right because only 15 feet ahead of me was the trail that would lead me out. Another scream bellowed from close in front of me. This time, I actually felt it, like the concussion you may feel from standing in front of a row of speakers at a concert. I froze. I couldn't even take one more step as fear gripped me. As my mind attempted to deal with the terror of the situation, I still managed to reason with myself, albeit barely. If I was going to survive, I needed to keep moving. I took a little sidestep, only to have the scream from whatever was close to me once more halt my escape. Whatever it wasn't going to let me go. I surrendered and dropped to my knees. I was surrounded now. Screams came from all directions. I plugged my ears and cried out, "I'm trying to go. I'm trying to go."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.